All right, so I think Mahima is like to join us. In the meantime, so Nivedita, are you done with the vaccination? Have you
Yeah, of course. Thankfully. Of course, the first one.
So how did you guys manage? Like, it was arranged by the organization?
We did it. We did it in the organization. We did it for the family and the dependents as well.
Oh, nice.
So all over India and Middle East, we did it ourselves. So that's where we could get it. In fact, the entire team could get vaccinated.
All right. Yeah. Hi, Mahima. Good evening. Hope you're audible to you.
Yes. Hi. Hi, everyone.
Hi. Welcome to the session. Yeah.
Perfect. I think we'll start.
Yeah. So we will just wait for another 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, Ravi, are you done with the vaccination?
Yes, we all have done, Ivan. Every employee, even we have covered even the contract workers across the plants here and there.
Really nice. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, you have arranged for them from the organization itself, is it?
Yes, from the organization. Special camps at our work locations and offices.
So, okay. I think that became easier, you know, for people to get it early. Otherwise, in Mumbai, particularly Delhi, we are quite okay. Mumbai, we are struggling. The families were struggling to get, vaccination. So because we procured in a, you know, as an organization, it was easier for us to avail the facility.
Oh, okay. That's nice. All right. Hi, Rajita. Is it all set now?
Yes, all set.
Great. All right. So, are you done with the vaccination, Rajita?
Yeah, I was late. I was like those who's going to say, jo hona hai, wo to hoega. Vaccination hua ya nahi hua. So, I didn't want to take the vaccination. I hate the prick. I hate the hospitals. I hate the tablets. So, ultimately, I did it just 2 weeks back. But for associates and family members across all of India, we've done that.
Okay. In fact, even I was in the same dilemma, whether to take or not take. I wanted to be the last person to take the vaccination there. Yeah.
That's what ended up happening, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Mahina, how about you? Done with the vaccination?
Yes, yes. I did it towards the beginning itself and for employees too. We managed to get the drive done for Bangalore, but for other locations, because employees have kind of, you know, scattered all over India now.
Correct. Yeah.
Just not getting enough mass employee base in any one location. So we eventually decided to go with reimbursements.
Okay.
Yeah. So people can get it done, whichever vaccine they want, whenever they want. And we just ensuring that they have the monetary support.
Yeah, that makes sense because you are keeping the option open to them. So they're not like forced upon them to you have to take or do it this way only. So I think that is the most convenient one.
True.
Yeah.
Mahima, if you're still open and people are not just wanting to do reimbursements and still expecting the company, we have almost 40% of our workforce across all of India. And we tied up with Apollo hospitals and Apollo clinics. So they could go into any of the closest Apollo clinic and get their jab over there too, if they were not comfortable doing the reimbursement mode, that is.
Oh, okay. That's really good. All right. So I think we can start the session now.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. Let me share my screen. Yeah. All right. So, good evening, everyone. This is Rashmi from GreyTip, and I would be the moderator for today's session. So, before I begin with anything else, I welcome all our beloved attendees and esteemed speakers, and also thank you all for coming together to discuss one of the most crucial issues that every organization is currently facing. It could be something like, how can organizations support their employees during this period of crisis? Or it could be even something like, what are the policies and benefits that organization should rethink and restructure to help employees better, right? Because end of the day, employees are the strength of every organization. We believe that, and we always be, right? So hence, by ensuring the health and happiness of the employees, every company is bound to bounce back and thrive as it moves forward post-COVID-19. So in our today's session, our speakers will share their insights and experience of how they have helped their organizations during this process of restructuring and implementing new policies and benefits to support the workforce. So first of all, I would like to start the session with the first guest speaker of our today's session, Mr. Ravi Mishra. So sir, welcome to the session once again. And to tell you more about Mr. Ravi Mishra, he's currently the Senior Vice President HR in Advanced Materials Business, a division of Grasim Industries Limited. He has been associated with human resources management in diversified organizations such as Nicholas Piramal Group, Mardia Group of Industries, Aditya Birla Chemicals, Ultratech Cement, and Birla Carbon. So, sir, a warm welcome to you once again. And I have a question for you, sir. We would like to have your expertise here. So, sir, according to you, what are the crucial HR policies that organizations should reconsider during this pandemic situation?
Thank you, Rashmi, for giving the opportunity to participate in this platform. So, during this pandemic, one of the most important factors, what we consider in Aditya Birla Group, and I personally very much resonated with that, the employee well-being. The first and foremost issue, what everybody challenged with employee well-being, how we can relook and make it a concern for every organization that how their employees are taken care of. So employee well-being as such is a very generic term in these days. So well-being has to be taken care in a multiple way. Right from emotional stress, financial support, medical support, challenges at the workplace, like in a city like Mumbai and many others metros, everybody at every level, they don't have a big houses, they don't have broadband, they don't have resources. Empathy shown by the managers for their fellow colleagues, direct reports. So we have gone all across this gamut of the employee well-being. How can we, like my other panels, informal conversation, they were sharing how they have facilitated the vaccination of their employees, retire with Apollo and Fortis or Nanavati, wherever the best facilities are available. So we had focused too much on the employee well-being. Few I can highlight, like one factor was emotional. We found that everyone, almost I can say more than 75% employee have some or other kind of stress, some bad incident either in the first phase and more so in the second phase. I remember many employees running with their parents from hospital to hospital. They were not getting the oxygen. So they were dying because of the lack of oxygen or medical support, and they cannot manage up their own. Here our organization came forward and we imported oxygen with the license from the Government of India to provide our people and their extended family in XYZ cities. One was a medical support during this crisis. And second is that how, when somebody is in a crisis, how can they perform at the workplace? So how much flexibility we can provide imply that first you take care of your family, forget for the work. And in many cases, I have seen even some of the employees came forward, then they told, I can do the work for her. She's in trouble. Don't bother her. Don't consider leave and blah, blah, blah. Employee care, well-being, right from supporting to employee and his family, medical, financial support. A lot of things we learned during this pandemic, for example, insurance facilities. So at a lower level of the pyramid, insurance coverage used to be for 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs. And we understand that these days we could know very easily, even if 2 persons have hospitalized in their family in the hospital, in a good hospital, So what used to be the bill? One is the emotional suffering that they are going through. Second is the economic and social support. So immediately in between, we changed our policy and spoke to the insurance agency, and we increased the minimum coverage for 5 lakhs. And if it is goes beyond the 5 lakhs bill, we have taken the money from benevolent fund and we have helped the employee so that that issue of the emotional trauma they can get rid of. So one, second was the work-related challenges. So empathy has to be developed. We all are not equally on the scale of the empathy when dealing with our direct reports or colleagues for the work challenges. So how we can train to the managers that you be empathetic to your colleagues, job and challenges and deliverables can be delayed. Taking care of the employees is the first priority. So in this direction, we have done lots of things. And those projects or those activities which is not very urgent, we delayed the target date so that employees should not feel the crunch. And all the time assuring the employee that no one should feel that we are going for any retrenchment drive or they have a challenge in the unemployment and all this. So we came forward and told that we will be last man standing in the companies who will go for the retrenchment or any kind of that stress. So whatever these kinds of support were there, we provided. But at the same time, we are looking how we can integrate it in a general policy of the HR, because this is a mass victim pandemic situation there. But time to time, this happens with one or two employees all the times. So in such a situation, how can our experience can be integrated on the as usual HR policy, that if there is some problem in a family, what should be the insurance coverage, what should be the flexibility, how in between, like for example, we have configured that if somebody has suffering some dreaded diseases, we will have some special additional insurance cover in that case if the normal insurance coverage is exhausted. So I can say the employee well-being but the first, and developing manager to be empathetic to their colleagues and their shareholder. For example, in a manufacturing plant, we have many plants at a very remote location where medical facilities are not available. How we can provide with the teleconsulting, how even in the surrounding area, in the rural India where there is a villagers are suffering with that, how we can support the same spirit with the villagers and contractor, even many drivers who are stuck at those locations. So we have been doing those things. So in the pandemic, these were very good a very adjustive experience we have added into the policies, starting from well-being. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. It's really good to know that the organization have always been there for the employees, because like you rightly mentioned, yes, it is a changing time for all of us and it was tough. It is still tough, of course, but yeah, somehow we have kind of got hang of it and we are trying to adapt ourselves to this. And while this shift is happening, the employees are getting emotionally affected by this. So taking care of their well-being will always be the prime focus of any organization. Thanks for bringing it up here, sir. So moving on to our next speaker, Ms. Nivedita Nanda, glad to have here. So friends, Ms. Nivedita Nanda, our guest speaker today, she currently works as Chief Human Resource Officer with Gaia India. And to tell you more about Nivedita, she's a passionate HR leader with a versatile experience in managing change, building culture, envisioning and establishing smart solutions for integrated people practice with ever dynamics business environment. So her leadership trait is enriched with multidimensional industry experts and a rare exposure to defense services. So once again, welcome Nivedita.
Thank you.
Nivedita, I would like to know from you. So how important do you think is to rethink and restructure the leave policies in the current situation?
I think it's extremely important. See, the COVID-19 pandemic has inspired and forced the HR leaders and their teams to think about the role of human resources. function. So if you see the beginning of 2020, you know, the organization quickly transitioned to a remote work model, right? And the in-person teamwork shifted to an online collaboration, what we're doing right now. You know, the reality of working from home was actually, you know, uncharted territory for most of us. You know, you talk about maybe a technology company will say this was very much familiar to me, but most of us were really, what is this work from home? Okay, so, but in spite of all these changes, even after a year, we have spent almost 15 months, okay, the workplace continues to evolve, you know, in response to the COVID-19. The pandemic has disrupted the organizations and caused people like us, you know, the human resource managers, to think very differently, you know, than the existing policies. So leave policy is one of the important thing, you know, which we are facing today. Or I'll talk about what we have done in our organization so that it will help the audience to maybe few things they can implement. So basically this whole 15 months, I would like to talk about how we have transitioned, you know, and I'll give three names to this entire, in fact, I'll categorize it into three phases. The first phase was the response, okay? All of us know it just happened and it was, we thought it is temporary. And we were very, very impulsive, what how we are responding to the situation. We thought it will go away, right? So we started talking about how we can have technology to people can work from home. How do we find productivity of people? And how do we rethink about our people's happiness? You know, this is what we thought. And the second phase I'll talk about is the recovery. You know, that before just the second phase. So exactly for the business or and for the people, people started recovering from that. Oh, it's going to remain with us. Okay, we need to think very structurally how we want to plan our organization as a business and people morale. Okay, I think currently we are into that position called thrive. I think you also use that word thrive. We are now rethinking, okay, this is the normal thing. Let's just come out of good policies, which will help the organization to, you know, be successful and also handle our employees' morale, happiness, their health. I agree with Ravi, you know, during that recovery period, we did exactly what he spoke. Okay, but now we have come out with very interesting policies, which has helped, like I manage the Middle East also. So I had to manage the Middle East business very differently than what we did in India. So we realized people are, during the recovery period, that people are falling sick. So let's immediately give them a 15 days leave sick leave. We didn't have this. I had one bucket of leave, 30 days. You just take it, you encash, whatever. Immediately I introduced a 15 days. If your family members or your you yourself is, you know, having COVID, let's have that 15 days sick leave. And it's only for the COVID. So immediately we introduced, so people were very happy saying that, yes, this is what organization cares about me, because as Ravi said, that empathy, care, you know, came very, became very important to us. Then we thought of, you know, in our organization, my average age for the employees is 34. So we realized we have a lot of old parents. That happened during that recovery period. The parents were falling sick and the youngsters had to take care of them. So I introduced a small leave policy called care for elders. So you can take, you know, 2-3 days extra leave, which we can help in terms of taking your parents to hospital. So people are very happy saying that, yes, they're the companies for there. But, you know, one has to understand this also as an organization, it, you know, your productivity goes down, right? So what should we, as an HR, we just can't think about people welfare, but we need to think how organization has to perform. So what we did is we introduced a beautiful concept, gift a leave. Okay, you can gift a leave, you can encash also. Suppose somebody has a financial problem, okay, your leave can be encashed for the person. Unfortunately, this is very difficult. We are struggling till today to, you know, know how technology should help me, you know, making it auto, that automation kind of thing. And also what we did is a capping of the encashment of leave. We can't just go, you know, absolutely in a way, employee welfare, wherein company also, because, you know, the encashment of leave is a huge burden to the organization. we also had to think of surviving, you know, as a business, as my bottom line, we had to survive, right? So that became my biggest worry, you know, that second phase, that recovery phase. We can't let the ship shrink. We have to survive. My only point was how all of us get salary, my employees get salary, and we came out of, and luckily my Middle East business started doing good. So we, India business, we have 100 clinics across India. We had tough time, but believe me, by August last year, we started jumping. Otherwise, we are absolutely closed. So what I did is that encashment of leave, we capped it. So with this, the business guys were okay, you know, and at the same time, the employees were fine. Believe me, that gift a leave has become so people are so happy with it. If people are really gifting the leave in terms of if anybody needs extra leave for the, you know, and also financially you can help. Of course, you know, we created a loan policy, but you had asked me only on leave, so I will be, you know, restricting my talk about the leave. Leave is a very sensitive topic to the employees. But believe me, how you communicate that encashment, you know, when you are capping, okay, many organizations have done that, I know. But how you communicate to people is very important at this point of time. You can't just have a policy. You have a good policy, you have a bad policy if you speak from the employee's angle. So the good policy is very much accepted. The moment 15 days, oh, everybody's happy. Okay, thank you so much to the management. But how do you communicate when you are in? You have to say this is what is important. You need to survive. You know, that's more important at this point of time. As a business, you can't let the ship sink. So these are the few things we have. And many policies I can talk, but I'm restrict. Many welfare policies, very interesting policies. How do we engage people? How did we, you know, when people are at home, how did we really connect with the families? How did we, a lot of policies, but leave with these 3-4 things we didn't, Rashmi. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much, Nivedita. I think that was very thoughtful. Like, for example, the care for elders leave, yeah, or gift a leave. I don't think so. Many of us could think of that during this tough time. So thanks for bringing it up. That was really thoughtful. Thank you, Nivedita. And dear attendees, moving on to our next speaker. Let me just share my screen. So here we also have our speaker, Ms. Rajita Singh, with all of us today. So Rajita is Head Human Resources of Broadridge Financial Solutions Private Limited, Hyderabad. Rajita Singh in many ways has represented the changing face in Indian IT and ITS industry, I can say, where human resource professionals are increasingly becoming strategic partners to the core functions. She has progressively taken diversified roles and increasing responsibilities across the HR function. So Rajita, once again, welcome to the session. Glad to have you here. And Rajita, I would like to know from you, how do you think that pandemic has made many employees' benefits redundant? And also, what are the top benefits that employers have to zero in to stay relevant in the current scenario?
Thanks, Rashmi, and thanks everybody for setting the context. I think what's important to understand is, as part of the pandemic, we talk policies. Policies can't be considered in isolation. So policies have to be considered based on where your associate population is, what your leadership is thinking, how your business is impacted, and how are you differentiating yourself from the others. So these are like some 4 or 5 parameters that you essentially need to be focusing on. And if you ask me, what did we do? I think, you know, we took a very measured and structured approach in the way we were looking at the scenario. First was, for some context, we never worked from home before the pandemic, right? Because of the contracts that we had with our clients that no work from home. When we get into office, we don't carry, you know, mobile phones. Our office mobile phones are restricted. No camera, no WhatsApp, no Facebook, no nothing. So in such a scenario where all of a sudden we had 4,000 offices across, right, because everybody started working from home, the definition of benefits changed. Earlier, the benefits were viewed from an associate standpoint, which is more like work-life balance, hygiene, I get free food in office and things like that. Now office is gone. So the applicability of benefits like free food, tea, coffee, you know, those events that you do where everybody is invited physically, you get some giveaways and all that, that entire story went out of the game. The second is, I think what also triggered is all of a sudden, health was very important and being alive was more important than anything else. So what does it take to be alive and how can an organization provide for a benefit on that front, right? The insurers had a gala time this time, right? So from medical insurance premiums to life covers to, you know, term life insurances to anything on, you know, future gratuity service laws and things like that, everything has been bumped up royally, okay, regardless of what people say. So when all companies were undergoing renewals, individuals also panicked, and those who were not planning, you know, like we have a pretty young workforce, around 27, 28 is our average age. So when you look at it from that standpoint, it is like, you know, no, I need to plan for this. No, I need this insurance. You know, no, even if I have ESI, if I fall in that bracket, I still need to do things. So I think what ended up happening is we said that we will provide with a platform where associates can also opt for their own in addition to what the company is doing. So that is one benefit that we did. Life insurance, as we all know, you know, went up for the organization. So providing for that kind of a buffer slash, I don't want to call it subsidy, but a little bit of a, you know, better how people can sign up for it is something that was discussed and debated a lot. Then, you know, you have very simple things, you know, on the benefits front, people used to work in the night. So they used to get a night shift allowance and then they used to get something for a travel allowance as well, right? If you travel in the night or otherwise. Now the travel is gone. On what basis are you giving a travel allowance to somebody? So essentially it impacts your compensation outright. So all these factors were reviewed and then, you know, it was out of the thing. Then when this goes out, the next thing is, how do I work from home? You know, I mean, I never had the internet. I needed, you know, continuous connectivity. I don't have a full-time UPS. I share an apartment with somebody or I'm in a hostel and things like that. So we broke down these infrastructural related things separately. And what we did is on a regular basis, we were taking input from our associates. So whatever came back to the leaders and to the core committee that was working on it, then it was further segregated and, you know, rolled out. So I'll give you a very simple example, like, you know, office attendance frequency. Offices are closed. People are working from home. There's fatigue. Do you want to give the flexibility that it's okay that, you know, the first half day you take off, don't show up to work? It's absolutely fine. Then the government introduced, you know, a law or a bill or whatever you want to call it, that I'll give you flexibility of compressed work weeks. You know, work only 4 days a week. You don't have to work 5 days or 6 days a week. So how is the organization taking to it? Are we allowing for that? Then the other thing that, you know, came into play was, if you look at mobility, now that people can work from anywhere, do they have, like, because we are present in almost about 18 to 20 countries, the question was, can I work out of this country because that's my hometown? Or can I go back, if we talk specific to India, you know, can I go back to Himachal because I'm from Himachal? I don't want to stay in Hyderabad or I don't want to stay in Bangalore or I don't want to stay in Delhi, right? So then when people go, do you do differential compensation? There were companies like the Facebooks of the world who came back and said, we will introduce differential compensation. So if you do that, are people wanting to stay with you? You know, there is a phenomena that came in that when policies are changing and there's so much of fluidity, not just, you know, within the organization, but personally also, and in the entire society, there's something called the great resign as a phenomena that's come up, right? So everybody is just going to resign and leave the workforce. What do you do then? How do you engage with people? So I think all those policies had to be factored in specifically on mobility. And then if you come back and, you know, talk of travel is totally gone. There were certain job roles that were thoroughly tied only to travel. And now when travel is totally cut out and you're supposed to work remotely, how do you alter your policy regards the job role of that person, the job autonomy you're going to provide that person? And how do people perform and how do you measure? So all these philosophical and fundamental conversations came into being, which essentially meant, you know, reshuffling practically everything that we're doing. Then, you know, from an ergonomic standpoint, what we ended up doing is, because people were working from home, you know, we sent out those kits of, you know, a table, a chair, so you can sit, you know, with comfort. And then, you know, a couple of headsets and mouse and keyboards and blah, 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 blah. So having provided for all of that, that was a one-time activity, right? We were all very optimistic. We thought COVID's going to go off in 9 months. COVID's back again, you know, with a bang. And we don't know what's going to happen in the third wave, if it's going to happen. So we ended up, you know, coming up with a policy that we're going to review this on an annual basis. And annually, there'll be an X amount of money that will be paid out to everybody. No questions asked as reimbursement. So just go ahead, whatever you need for your home office, and you know, you come back. So these were at a high level, you know, with regards to what we did. Of course, there are a lot of companies that came up with, primarily the focus on for them was on telecommuting policy and procedure, if you talk of it from the IT and ITS standpoint. But to me, it was not just telecommuting. It was looking at, you know, your night shift allowances. It was looking at, because you're working in the night, right? You're with family. You're not in office. You're awake, your whole family is sleeping. How do I get motivated to work? At least in office, you had, you know, around 100, 200 people working for you. It didn't matter so much. So coming up with nuances around that and solving for it is, I think, what really made the difference for us.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing your insights, Rajita. That's really true, because we thought it's just the temporary period that all of us have to go through and then we will be back to our normal lives. But no, it came with a whole lot of baggage, a lot of practical issues, right from basics till the high end of it. Right. So somehow we are all still trying to cope up with that. Yeah. In the meantime, I would like to take this forward to our next guest speaker, Ms. Mahima. Hi, Mahima. Welcome to this session. It's our pleasure to have you. So Mahima is an HR professional with more than a decade of experience in the areas of global compensation and benefits, HR compliance, diversity and inclusion, and HR shared services. So Mahima is currently serving as a director, culture and talent at Sprinklaw. So Mahima, I have a question for you here. Please let us know your thoughts on this. So Mahima, what do you think? How care benefits have taken the center stage in supporting employees navigate through the crisis?
Rashmi, thank you, first of all, for inviting and giving us a chance to speak at this forum. Well, I think all of the other esteemed guests, we all spoke about elements of benefits that had, nuances around care, essentially, right? What COVID did to us, and not just as HR professionals, I think we had an equal partnership with our business leaders as well, is to bring in the empathy side of leadership traits and engage with employees on a very, very high level. And particularly the second wave, I think first wave was still comparatively easy to kind of navigate through. People were just, organizations just figuring out how to just transition into the virtual mode of working, but it was not as bad when it comes to the benefits or the other things. It was comparatively an easier transition on the benefits front. It was mostly from other processes standpoint that how do you suddenly, you know, start operating virtually. I think second wave brought out all the other elements around, you know, how we operate at a really, really human level with and bringing together everyone as a team, as a family. We have our R&D center based out of Gurgaon, and Delhi was one of the worst hit cities. We had almost 200 plus employees affected, employees or their families affected. I think what really, and during the pandemic, there's a lot of, what we did was, you know, used our own expertise in our technology and created, and we work on social media. So what we did was, created a dashboard, and the Sprinklaw dashboard, I think, became very, really viral in India. So all the information around, you know, availability of hospital, medicine, oxygen, everything was available on that, on a real-time basis on the dashboard. And this was not led by HR, this was not led by leaders, this was all employee-driven. Overnight, we had an army of Sprinklawites who were, all they were doing was tracking who needs help, where do they need it, and just ensuring that, you know, things are available to them. Calling up vendors from, you know, wherever they are getting their data sources from, different suppliers on medicine, on oxygen concentrators, or oxygen cylinders, and all of those things. And these are all elements of how you really care for each other and how you really come together as an organization too in such difficult times. So that was really a great moment as an organization, as a HR professional, to see how, you know, we all transform ourselves in the hours of need. Things around what we others spoke about, insurances, for example, you know, traditional insurance was not really helping people. No one was getting a bed in hospital with just because it was part of your network. You needed to pay in cash. You needed to, even if you had a bed in one of the top hospitals, you still were not sure if you get an oxygen supply there. So there were everything that, you know, organizations were doing, which was really over and above. Nothing had, there was no precedence. There was no, none of the traditional things were really working in that really period of time. And so it was really driven through empathy. It was really driven through a sense of community. And that's how we kind of really worked and ensured that we managed to, you know, get by this phase without any really, you know, worst cases from our employee perspective. A lot of things also changed, for example, on the home care front, and how you take care of your family, how you take care of your kids while they are all having online classes. And it, you know, initially, I think it was still all right. In the first 3-4 months, people were fine to be at home. When it has continued for 1-1.5 years, it's just really like becoming very, very difficult for people to just, you know, keep going on. So just that finding that motivation to kind of keep going on and ensuring that the stress and the mental fatigue that you're seeing is addressed. So we did a lot of sessions in EAP as well. And we did a lot of sessions for the teams who were providing that support. So for example, HR professionals, for example, us, our lot, we were talking to employees on a daily basis. I mean, what we were going through in our personal lives is a separate thing altogether, right? But when you're hearing all negative news and you're still trying to be positive, you're still trying to give that other person so much strength, your own mental condition takes for a beating. So how we can come together as a community, as a group, and use these sessions really well was some of the other things that we did. I think this whole pandemic has perhaps taught us that what we can do together as a family within an organization. I think those values have really come to the fore during this time.
Yeah. That's really true, Mahima, because yeah, of course times were tough, but adapting to these new changes was quite difficult, and being there for the employees, that was very important. So that's when actually I think the other individuals realized that how far we can go to help our colleagues or teammates or being for them, being that empathetic, like a few of you rightly mentioned. Yes. So thanks for sharing it here, Mahima. So I think with this, we have got few expert tips now. And dear attendees, we are now opening up for Q&A round. So if you have any questions for our speakers today, please post it in the Q&A and we will be glad to take it up and try and answer them. So you can just type in your questions in the Q&A tab there and we will take them up online. So I can see that there are a few questions already lined up here. So one is from Mr. Nupur. Hi, Nupur. And Nupur's question is, how difficult it would have been to convince and present reports to management to come up with the employee-centric well-being initiatives, specifically in SME? So I think Nivedita will be the right person to provide her expertise. So Nivedita, would you like to share your thoughts here?
Yeah, so let me just read once more how could have been difficult to convince present reports to management to come on. Okay. See, I'll tell you something. When you say you don't have to convince the management, SMEs have actually undergone a tough time last 1 year. Let's understand what did they do to come out of it. First of all, they manage their overhead. Okay. They a good organization. I'm talking about good organization. I'm really not talking about organization who are not empathetic towards the people, right? I know a few SMEs how they did it. They called the people, they created that you all are the owners of the company. What will you do if you are the owner? Today, your family is undergoing a problem. What will you do? First, cut down your overhead costs. The moment you cut down overhead costs, that for SMEs actually didn't think about how to give extra leave to people. The first thing was to survive. And the SMEs which survived last year, believe me, they are doing really good now because they knew the traits, the secrets, how to survive at the same time, making people aware. The moment you have very good communication with people, saying that, and everyone else accept, everybody needs a job in SME, the skill set people come in, they need, of course, there are a lot of resignations. I think Rajita spoke about the resignations and how people started. In my organization, I had good people started leaving. But one thing which people SME survived is proper communication and be transparent and be honest with people. Believe me, even employees also will trust the management, and management never wants to, harm anything, never wants to ask people to go, okay? If it is not, they first wanted to survive, they first wanted to have the business in place. So then they thought about, let's accept, I spoke to you, encashment, leave encashment, we put a cap, right? Let's accept this fact. The moment you accept the strong things, this is going to happen. First is survival, right? And they survived and they thrived after that. The communication part was very important for the SMEs to do. And they did, trust me, a lot of automation. The report says the kind of automation has happened last 1 year. It had not happened in India prior to this. They understood that's the most important thing. They wanted to, some of the organization, I can name the organization who have done so well. Okay, of course, those are in internet space. They have really done well. The small Kirana stores have done really good. Okay, you have to understand they manage their overhead cost. Okay, they manage the people. I think that was the important thing. I hope that answers your question. When you manage your people, the SMEs, they treat their employees like their own family. If I, a lot of systems they created, that care benefits. They came out with a lot of care benefits. Can I give an interest-free loan if I have? That's the first thing to do. And people had a lot of issues. I must tell, insurance, people who are hospitalized were quite well taken care of because they had the insurance. But people who stayed at home, the cost for employees were very high. And believe me, SMEs have managed it pretty well than any multinational companies. I can tell you stories how people have managed, the COVID patient who stayed at home, the kind of reports they had to go through, these were not reimbursed, right? Hospitalization was only one thing they had that point of time. So they have done very good, that care benefits actually took the precedence here. They gave importance to that, any benefits, other benefits as such. Yeah, hope that answers.
Yeah. Thanks, Nivedita. Yeah, that does. And also good that you brought up the topic of automation.
Yeah.
Ravi sir, I have a question for you. Since we are already talking about automation, so what do you think, sir? How technology can help HR in executing these new policies and benefits, especially during this pandemic? Sir, I think you're on mute. Sorry to interrupt. You're on mute.
Sorry. Also, what Nivedita is saying about automation, this is also great learning for all, whether it is SME or MSME or large organization. They have seen the value of the automation at the workplace. It has increased a lot, and it is going to increase further. Basically, especially in SME and in a manufacturing sector, still we are lagging with the work. For level of global parameter, automation is very low. This is to be highlighted. Second, But we also learned that there are certain works which needs only for few hours in a month or maybe few hours in a week. So we are also thinking to build up a structure where there is a specialty job and we don't need a person for 8 hours a day. In place of that, we have some sort of retainership relationship with the employees for say 20 hours in a week or 15 hours in a week. And the same guy who is highly skilled, he can have a retainership with 2-3 companies. So that employee has also flexibility to work for many organizations. He's helping to many organizations at the same time. And organizations are also benefited not to have all the people for all the time, for all the season without any need. So automation is one, and evaluation of the work profile. So both have been blended very well. Third is whatever management is doing, how you are able to communicate, because whenever you talk about manpower structure and all that, one fear, and basically this pandemic, where people had a fear of losing the job or something like this. So once you talk about the automation, people see very differently what is going to happen on their job and their career. So how candidly you communicate whatever you have in mind while building the trust with the people. So that's not the problem, but Nivedita was saying the experience, communicate and communicate. That's the best choice. You are mute, Rashmi.
Okay, sorry for that. Okay, yes, sir, you are right. Like you rightly mentioned, it's like learning never stops, right? Even during these tough times, a lot of us realize that there's a lot of scope to do much more than what we thought. Yes, we are done with everything. That's truly, thanks for bringing it up here, sir. And moving on to our next question, there are a couple of questions. Glad to see these many here. So one of our attendees, Mr. Prakash, has asked us, I think this is quite generic as well, but it is definitely worth bringing it up here. Work from home should be as part of policy. Please suggest. So,
yes, I mean, it's a pretty obvious question. The question has the answer. So it has to be a part of the policy. There's no going back on that. And especially, I think what's important to understand is the way organizations function, the way organizations are structured right now, it's going to change. So it is going to be a hybrid model. It is going to be virtual, remote, complete remote, and partial. So it is going to be a part of the policy for sure.
Yes. Mahima, would you like to add something here?
Rashmi, yeah, we are a tech company. So for us, there is absolutely no question. Also, we were perhaps working, using work from home quite liberally even earlier. Mm-hmm. And there's absolutely sort of no going back from what we've seen in the last 1.5 years. It'll be good to go in office, but it won't be like a permanent thing. Right. It will, the future work will perhaps definitely have a hybrid model working for our kind of industry.
Great, yeah. So in the similar lines, I have another question. I think it's from Ms. Abita. So Abita's question is, what are the ways to keep our employees and their family refreshed? So I think this is something similar to the lines we were talking about, the motivating the employees. Right. So I think Abita is looking for a few suggestions. So anybody who would like to add in here?
Go ahead, Ravi.
No, please.
Also, in our sector, we used to have lots of celebration along with family. Even when we invite the employees to come for the award, whether from US or Europe or in Delhi or Calcutta, they are invited along with their family. And they have engagement with the other employees, family, and all that for 3 days, like in Bombay every year, or sometimes it has happened overseas and Jaipur and something like this. So how frequently you can engage the family with such celebration with their co-employee, and particularly what Maima was saying in her organization, it is a very obvious to hybrid and flexibility. So in those organizations, even it is much more needed that sometimes maybe once in a month, some sort of evening gathering with dinner with the family, whole family can be done. It's a very motivating and engaging, once one family engages with the whole family.
Okay. Yes, sir. So agreed. So next question is from a few of our attendees. I think this question is from Nivedita. They have specifically mentioned it. So Nivedita, our attendees would like to know more about the gift leave. And also another question with respect to that is, what are the other policies that you have redesigned or new policies that you have introduced?
Okay. So one of the good policy which we started is we realized the young mothers, you know, the creches are closed. Let's understand that, you know, how will the mothers will come to work? Because our clinics were open, how will they come to work, or the back-end people, till today we have been operating from home last one, all the back-end people. So how the problem was the crèche, all the crèches are closed, even till today it hasn't opened. So we created a policy where you can come and work for 4 hours, you can work for 5 hours, so that if you have a husband, you have in-laws, you have your parents, they can look after the kid. And so this flexi hour was never there with us. So, you know, somebody will ask after this question, the productivity, right? How I was very, very clear to people, if 4 hours, the salary has to be for 4 hours. It cannot be that, okay, I was getting X salary and I will get, you know, X plus. No. Believe me, last year we gave our performance bonus to everyone because we worked. But it was very clear. If so, the so-called gig culture, what is coming in, we have already started in our organization. Another very interesting policy which we did, I think, you know, any one of you can implement this policy, is you know, how your contract workers, okay? Because we have a lot of people, we don't have many contract. Our housekeeping in the clinics are contract workers. Immediately we gave them the, we forced our service provider to give insurance, to give healthcare assistance, which earlier, you know, I was really not much, you know, I used to think they must be doing, trust me. So it gave us that, that empathy, what Ravi was talking about, it came in place. The contract workers immediately started, you know, we started looking after them. I think that has, that has become really important. And we also, another question is, you know, how you engaged, somebody was saying, we invested on an LMS immediately, which was not there before. And now we have done that. You have to complete this many hours of learning. That's a mandatory policy we created. With that, people started getting excited. Yes, for example, we have 93 SKUs products. Okay, we never used to tell people how to sell. It was always a suggestive selling, but we never had, you know, the training. Now, my entire productivity or my entire performance bonus is also, training is a part of it, which is not there before, which all of you can do. Yeah. And second question was the gift policy. The gift policy is if somebody has already exhausted the leaves, okay, she can approach whom she knows or whom she thinks or he thinks can give leave. You can ask for the leave, and we kept it for 15 days. Maximum leave you can gift is 15 days. So you can take the leaves from the person. Okay, one more thing I forgot to mention here. We had a January to December leave cycle. I changed it to March. There's one more good thing I did. Because people couldn't take leave because they were at home, right? We didn't know how that so-called work from home concept. This is also we did at, we changed the cycle of the leave policy. We extended it for till this year. I don't know whether I'll do it or not, but last year we extended it to March. So the gift policy coming back, you can, or somebody having financial issues, okay? If I have 30 days, everybody is going through this, everybody has issues in fund, right? I can't really help someone financially, but I can give, okay, 10 days of my, that's a 10 day salary. The 10 days leave is a 10 day salary. Imagine the kind of money, one will get, a senior management person if I have gifted, you know, a leave. What I was telling Rashmi, you couldn't automate this. So my HR operation team is really struggling to maintain it, you know, in Excel sheet at this point of time. But I want to automate. I've spoken to other people to automate, but that's a gift. You can avail leave or you can encash, but maximum 50 days.
Yes.
Hope that suffice.
Yeah. Thank you, Nidhi. So Mahima, I think we have a next question for you. There's our attendee, Ms. Deepa. And hi, Deepa, we are taking up your question. So Deepa's question is, due to the pandemic, most employees are unable to use their paid leaves, like EL, CL, and a large accumulation of encashable leaves such as EL increases the employee cost for organizations. Would like to know how organizations are dealing with such accumulations. Like, for example, the employees being asked to take compulsorily avail the leaves or encashment has been stopped. So Mahima would like to from here.
Thanks, Rashmi. See, in our case, we are sort of comfortable with carrying over that liability, but I do understand that it's a reality for many organizations that the liability on your books continue to increase. What many people have done is perhaps what she was suggesting, Nivedita was suggesting earlier, is to gift leave. That's something that many organizations have done. Some have enforced leaves in certain cases so that you are able to manage it. And some have allowed for encashment to kind of also ensure that their financial liabilities are sort of taken care of, because your accumulated leaves you will encash in a normal circumstance only when you leave the organization. So allowing for an early encashment perhaps also helps people financially to tide over the situation in case they have a COVID case at home. So these are some of the measures that many organizations that I closely work with or have an association with, have done. Our organization per se, we were comfortable with carrying that thing on our book, the liability on our book. So we didn't do anything in particular for that.
All right, yeah, thank you, Mahima. So Deepa, I hope that helps. And dear attendees, due to interest of time, we are not able to answer all of your questions. Really sorry for that, but you can definitely get in touch with us and get your answers as well. And for today's session, one last question I would like to take up. This is from Mr. Shivanand. So I think, Ravi sir, you can provide your expertise here to us. So Shivanand's question is, how to handle work from home perks in terms of taxation, whether these perks are taxable in the hands of employee? Like, for example, if company allows employees to buy table, chair, monitor, and reimburse them?
Yes, we have allowed employees to buy these resources. buy these resources, and we are reimbursing. And not only that, we have given some 20,000 rupees flexible fund, that whatever they need, by the way, if they have a table chair, they want to go for a lamp or anything else, they can buy it and get it reimbursed. So all the facilities are well provided. Like sometimes they have problem that I have bought 2 months back. So we have given the flexibility, even if you have bought it first April 2020 onwards, even the bill is in your spouse's name, it doesn't matter. You submit the bill and you will get the reimbursement. So these facilities, we have helped a lot to employ in terms of leave, like terms of resources. Like for all employees who are, by this some reason, they have to come to the office for 2 hours or even 3 hours. We have provided them exclusive car by a vendor who's a very well known. Sanitization, all the extra care taken for the COVID. So that facility is very much there, and that is how employee can be engaged and motivated. And that flexibility in Aditya Birla Group, we have a lot. Since we are into large organizations, so sometimes what happened, some companies are not booking good profit, somebody has done a very good profit, even last pandemic year. For example, in our business, in my business, in advanced material, we have done more than what we used to book the profit in general normal years, and some company may not have done so. That's not the burden or constraint for that. But in employee concern, we have taken care of. For all these flexibility of reimbursing XYZ.
All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your insights. So I hope that answers the question. And also, dear attendees, like I already said, I can still see a few questions coming up, but you can definitely drop in a mail to us. We'll take it up and we'll also try and provide you the solutions from our expert speakers here. So I think after all of this, now it's already 5 o'clock. So a few of attendees might be cursing me as well. You took our extra 2 minutes, Rashmi. So I think it's now time to end the session, but I would like to end it on a note that changing is never effortless. So we definitely have realized this after all of this discussion, right? So it's natural to experience a few bumps in this process of change, especially when our life is turned upside down from an unforeseen virus that shook the entire world, right? So we may not have control with it much right now, but what we do have is control over our HR policies. So we hope that this session has helped you with practical case studies and valuable insights on how we can frame policies and benefits to help our employees during this time of crisis. So once again, would like to thank you all our speakers for sparing their time out of their busy schedule and joining us in this session. Thank you all again. And also thank you for providing your valuable suggestions and insights. I'm sure this has helped our attendees a lot. And also the attendees, we thank you, all of you once again for joining us and making this session so engaging with all your queries. And we will soon share the recording of this session. I can see one of you have requested it already. So we will definitely share this recording shortly with you. And for any queries, you can always write back to us at the email ID, sharmishta@greatip.com. I'll also share the email ID here. So as you can see, this is the mail ID. You can always drop in your queries here. And if at all you'd like to connect with us more and get the solutions or answers for your questions or anything related to compliance, we have our own community here, attendees. So that is Great Tribe. We have also given the link here. So basically, Great Tribe is the knowledge sharing platform where we have all the industry experts and many more HR and payroll experts here, the POs. So you can always visit our Great Tribe community. And if you have any questions, please do feel free to drop in your questions there. All right. So on this note, I'm going to end the session now. Thank you all once again.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So thank you guys. Hope to see you in the next session soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.